I'm running for governor to bring Minnesota together and get things done. We live in a time of so much gridlock. You see it in Washington. You see it in St. Paul. People are butting heads. You know, the parties aren't getting things done that they need to be getting done. In this last legislative session, we saw a lot of things that the parties seemingly agreed on, dealing with the opioid crisis, having tax conformity, protecting our senior citizens in nursing homes, but yet we didn't get those kind of reforms passed. I've got a track record as Attorney General on taking on tough problems and getting solutions for people, taking on problems other people don't want to solve. You know, the water quality problem in the East Metropolitan area with 3M went on for decades. Agencies didn't do anything about it. The legislature didn't do anything about it. And I jumped in and got the biggest environmental settlement in Minnesota history, 100 times the next biggest settlement. Children's Hospital and Blue Cross were having a contract dispute where for weeks it was going on where they didn't have a contract, and I was watching this occur and took the two CEOs together, and you know, it's arguably the responsibility of the Commissioner of Commerce to do that, but it wasn't happening, and I jumped in and said to both CEOs, let's sit down and talk and try to get business done, and we got a contract. A couple of my skills as Attorney General are negotiating. I'm a negotiator. Most of the big settlements in the Attorney General's office that have happened over the years and big resolutions, I've been personally involved in negotiating, and then being an advocate for Minnesota. And one of the things I want to do before taking office is to meet with Congressman Nolan and all 201 legislators, Republicans and Democrats across the aisle, get to know them, what motivated them to run, and then find ways to move Minnesota forward. And I think with the track record I have with results, we can do that.
Just look back a little bit at Governor Dayton's legacy. Is there anything about some of the things that he enacted that you would not have done, or is there anything that stands out to you that you wouldn't have done?
Sure. So I guess the way I would look at it, I want to give Governor Dayton high marks and a couple things in particular. One would be the budget and trying to solve and budget in an honest way. I mean, up until then, the state was doing accounting gimmicks and shifts and, you know, wasn't very transparent in terms of the budgeting. And I think he's really put Minnesota on a much better fiscal foot, and that's good. Second would be education. I think he's really indicated he wanted to make education the hallmark of his administration from day one, and he's done that. I think that's great. How I look at kind of what I might do differently is really using my own skill set as Attorney General to approach the job in my own way. And so we are going to be very engaged with the legislature from the beginning, even before I take office, to try to meet with them and get to know them and see if we can't play a role in helping to end, you know, some of the bickering that is going on. And I would start early in the session, not toward the end of the session, but early in the session, sort of lay the cards on the table and figure out how do we try to move things forward. I think that's important that we do that, and we're going to try our best to try to bring Minnesota together.
The kind of narrative or the give and take lately has been transit versus highway lanes.
We need to do all of the above, really. When you look at transportation, you know, 40% of our bridges are over 40 years old. 50% of our highways are over 50 years old. The average Minnesotan spends 40 hours a year stuck in traffic. And this metropolitan area in Minneapolis is the most, I think, 15th most congested in the country. And so we need to do both highways and transit of all types. We need to do it in both the metropolitan area as well as greater Minnesota. What I would do is bring stakeholders together. We need to have long-term sustainable funding sources as well for transportation. Problem with the gas tax is it's diminished. And when it was passed in 2008, I think fully effective in 2012, it was 28.5 cents per gallon. And 28.5 cents per gallon, but it doesn't have an inflator, so that stays a constant rate. And then people aren't driving as far, and the cars get such better gas mileage than they used to. We're talking in 10 years maybe having cars that go 50 miles a gallon on average, so the gas tax alone isn't going to be able to fund what our transportation needs are, and we're going to have to find long-term sustainable funding sources.
Firearms has been a big issue at the Capitol. Which of these ideas are you endorsing at this point?
Sure. Well, I think we need to do a number of things when it comes to school safety. I support better background checks for guns. I support red flag provision that would allow judges to temporarily remove guns following a due process hearing from people who are dangerous and shouldn't have them because they pose a danger to themselves and others, as well as a ban on bump stocks. I've advocated for a ban on bump stocks as Attorney General. I think we need to go further than that, though. We need to do more to keep our schools safe. The school safety funding was another provision that was caught up in the end of session kind of problems, and so money for school safety didn't occur. If you walk into a courthouse and you walk into an airport, you know, you have metal detectors, you have buildings that are secure. our schools are not as secure as they need to be, and I'd like to and will get more money to our schools to deal with that. Also think we need to deal with mental illness. One of the things I want to have be a moonshot of my administration is tackling the challenge of mental health and chemical dependency. For every dollar you spend treating opioid addiction, you save $4 in healthcare costs and $7 in criminal justice costs. And we don't do nearly enough to understand the human brain. And my moonshot is going to be really focusing on mental health and doing far, far more to treat and diagnose mental illness. Minnesota, we're fourth from the bottom in the number of school counselors. We have, I think, one school counselor for every 723 kids, fourth worst in the country. I'd up that. I'd bring money to the schools so we can have more counselors who can then identify the kids who might pose a risk. Oftentimes these shootings, you know, it's the kid who was bullied or expelled or had problems in their life, and having more counselors could help find and identify those kids. And I think it's important. We have other mental health challenges. I mean, the drug addiction and mental health challenges kind of go hand in hand. Oftentimes one can lead to the other. We don't do enough to treat opioid addiction and drug addiction as well. We don't have enough treatment facilities, especially in greater Minnesota. We don't have nearly the capacity we need to treat mental illness. And same with mental health. You know, parents tell me all the time, you know, our kid needs to be in residential mental health treatment. They suffer from, you know, bipolar disease or schizophrenia or other conditions, and they can't find residential facilities in Minnesota, and they're shipping them to Eau Claire and North Dakota and all over the country. We need to build out more capacity to treat kids here in the state of Minnesota where they're closer to the parents where they need to be at that time in their life. I'd do that. And then as well, just you see, you know, problems with mentally ill people that judges have ordered to get treatment remaining in prison because there's not enough capacity to treat them in the system, and we need to build that out too and just do far more. And it takes a little money to do that, but in the long run, it's going to be money saved. It's not just the morally right thing to do, but it's going to save the state money by treating these problems on the front end.
So smart money.
Smart money, as opposed to, yeah, just kicking the can down the road and spending more later. At this unique time in our country's history, and it even goes beyond gridlock, one of the things I'm so concerned about is the lack of respect and civility and dignity in the political process. It used to be people would respect each other even if they disagreed, but now you're seeing them where that you're not supposed to care about the plight of others unless it benefits you. You're not supposed to listen to somebody else unless you agree with them. And I just think we need people who are going to not do that, who are going to cut through that and restore some civility and just work on getting stuff done for the public.